editing softwares. Dr. Prithvi, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Rajesh, sir, and thank you, Namrata, ma'am, for the opportunity. Also, like to thank Iskris and Dr. Prasanna for giving me this opportunity to present my topic. I'm just going to share my video right now. I hope it's visible.
Yeah, it is.
So, my topic today is on innovative academic filmmaking. And that too with the making most of the existing video editing software which we have in our laptops. So I'm Dr. Prithvi. So the question is, why presentation or video or filmmaking is important? As an ophthalmic person, why is it so important to make presentations, video and films? Basically because we need people to know and know our ideas. That is the main reason why we make presentations. And what if we have everything written in the presentation? Might as well just publish it, right? Why do we have to make it into a presentation? A presentation should look good, look attractive. So the basic thing is visualize and understanding. So we show visually attractive presentation for people to understand what we have to convey. So without much delay, I would like to tell my 10 steps of making video and presentations. So here we go. The first and foremost thing is the topic and the script. Many of them actually don't give a lot of importance to script, but actually the script is the backbone for any video or a film or a presentation. So we always have to have a script, a thorough good understanding of the script and the topic. So, and then one, having a good software. So the second thing is having a good software. So I basically work on PowerPoint, Keynote, and iMovies. So the PowerPoint and Keynote, we can make a lot of animations, and then we can regulate it or cut it, fix it with the iMovies or any other software which people use. Most of the video editing softwares are similar. Third step is to get a template or a theme. So a lot of themes can be actually obtained free or paid from internet through these sites. Isn't it actually boring using all the same PowerPoint slides every time we use it? So we can actually go on in the internet and search in the Google for these kind of website where they give free good new every week they get new templates on for PowerPoints or Keynote presentations. So here are a few of them. As you can see, this one is a war background template. This is for the COVID template. Here we have a template which looks like a comic book. Here we have something for a Halloween themed presentation. Here we have a vintage clinical case kind of presentation slide. Even there are other medical presentation slides too. So this will actually make your presentation look much pretty, much, much attractive. And people actually will focus into these kind of presentation templates. As you can see the background is also a template which I've used over here. The fourth step is to get fonts, which are equally good for the templates or the themes you have used. So Google fonts give a lot of good fonts for free. This is another website which give good fonts. So playing with fonts, which actually complement your theme and background will actually make it look more attractive. The next one is, so these are all the fonts which I have already installed in my laptop. So I use these fonts according to the theme which I usually use, according to the themes which I download from the internet. Then comes another thing, the fifth step is images, using images, clip arts and icons. So images can be freely downloaded without any copyright, or if you have need copyright, you can even pay for the images which you can we can download from the internet. And these are all images, cartoonified images which you can use. And there are GIF images. These are all GIF images. If you can see it, it moves. So if just for an example, if you are showing a cataract or a surgery which has been complicated, and then you can use these kind of images or GIF images to make it more, you know, funny. And when you actually the complication is managed well, you can use these kind of images, as you can see. And then if you have to mock the audience just in a funny way, you can even put like this Michael Jackson GIF image. And there are all of the other icons which you can use to cartoonify your presentation. So here I'll just show a demo on how image editing is done. So if you can see over here, this is an image. We can even crop the images as you wish. And once you cropped it, you can make it large and you can even remove the background. So there's provision in Keynotes to even remove the background. If you do this, the background changes. And you can even make it a single photo in a frame, so that it becomes easier for you. And you can just use this particular image just like that. You want to remove the background of this one, you can even try removing the background of that one. So then this becomes transparent, like you see. So that is about images, clip arts, and icons. The next thing is using music and audio. So you get free music and Bend sounds, and even in Google, YouTube, where you can download and, you know, play a lot of musics and audio clips for free and without clip arts, without copyrights. So all this can be used in your presentation, and which makes it more attractive. The next thing is animations and effects. Now you can see in this side, you can see these are all the animations and effects which are already there in the Microsoft PowerPoint, which are underused. And again, these are the ones which you use, which we get in Keynote for MacBook. And these are all actually underused. Not people use these animation, but we can actually use it for our benefit. I could show you a few. So over here, we go here for animation and add an animation. So if you want this, you can see how it falls from up, or you can just make it pop, drop it, or even move it, move in and out. So these are all very simple animations which can be used, but not many people actually use it nowadays. The next thing is the transitions. So transitions are also available in PowerPoint and in MacBook Keynotes. As you can see, all of my slides in this presentation has been used as a transition, like this one, you can see. And then the ninth step is editing the shape. So now you can even use Keynotes has enabled us to even use this edit option. So you can make it editable and you can edit these shapes. So if you want to edit such a way that you want to make this design over here, you can make it using this tool. As you can see, you can just easily make this to make this design over here. It looks so similar, and you can use it to do it, any kind of design. And then this is how it looks. So it is very editable, very user friendly. It's very easy to use as well. So this is the ninth thing, is editing shapes. You can edit any kind of shape. One more example I'll give is, if you can see this is a template already made, but I have replicated these template designs. And when I press this, today's topic, and see how these move. So you can use this transition called the magic move to actually make these design move continuously during the presentation, which looks really cool. And the last part, the last step is movie editing. So I do movie editing using Apple iMovies, which is pretty much free, and it comes with the MacBook. But Windows, you can use Camtasia, and for iPad, you can use LumaFusion. And if you could see over here, sorry, the video editing, is it visible over? Is it visible now?
No, Prithvi.
No, sir.
No. You need to reduce the keynote and then show your...
Okay. Yeah, I think now it's visible.
Yeah. Yes.
This is a small thing I made using the iMovies. You can see over here. So this is a timeline or a trackpad where you can edit it. So you can kind of split it by command B, split here, and you can delete it, or you can make it fast by making it 4x or 8x, or make it even slow. So things move much slower. So these are all the images, the templates which we used in keynotes, which are converted into iMovies format. If you can see, we can go over here, export any of these slides into movies. So once you make these movies, you can export it back to iMovies and edit if you want to make it fast, slow, or even if you want to crop the image in multiple ways, can make it easier for you to edit. So these kind of software actually helps you edit your whole video. So these are all the animation effects which we use in keynotes, and then we are editing these videos, merging it or splitting it in iMovies. There are a lot of other options. You have audio clips, titles, backgrounds, all in iMovies, which are for free. As you can see, all these things are a combination of iMovies with Keynote, which makes the video experience really good. It makes the whole thing very smooth as well. So going back to the presentation, there are a few other examples which I would like to give here. So as I, when I present a case report, I don't present it like a whole bullet wise or a paragraph wise, like sentences. This is how I present a case report. When it comes to case report, it comes like 58-year-old male with an icon or a clip art or an image which I've taken from Google. And then I remove the background, and it looks like a 58-year-old male who is having a problem with the right eye. And then you have the history coming there, systemic, and then you zoom in. So this is the magic move we use the magic move over here. If you can see the animation over here, we used the magic move. Yeah, magic move over here, which actually lets us move the clip or the icon or the photo in front over here. And then we can even make it like right eye, this is the finding, and the left eye has this findings. And then if you have a fundus image over here, we can even, you know, zoom into these fundus images and show each and every detail of the disc and macula or whatever it is in a much more better manner than just writing it as, you know, blurred disc margins or mild pallor. And if there is an OCT image where you want to show all the signs, now you can even make the necessary adjustments with the editing tool, which I told, and you can make all these dotted lines to show the signs, and even, you know, you can change the thing for cavitation. You can just edit in such a manner. It is very clear for the person or the audience who is looking at it. So that is all I have to tell about filmmaking and PPT editing. It goes hand in hand. Thank you.
Thank you, Prithvi. It was really nice and very nice way to present, say, a case report, actually, you know, showing what exactly you mean by, say a 58-year-old male having this complaint and all that. That was really very nice and interesting. There are a couple of questions for you, Prithvi, before we actually, you know, we can have the other panelists also, other speakers also can, you know, start discussing. You talked about the templates. So there's a question for you that where from do you get those templates?
Yeah, there are a lot of websites in Google you can search for. Like I usually use Slidesgo, Slidesgo. There are a lot of other free websites where you can actually download these templates from. And these templates are not restricted to any one theme. It keeps on updating. They keep updating on a daily basis, on the daily current affairs, what's happening. If it's COVID, they have a template for COVID. Not just one, they have many more templates. Basically, it's all uploaded by the users itself. And a few of the templates which have animation inbuilt come for a price also. So if you want to buy that, we can even buy those templates. And there are templates even which provided by the Microsoft PowerPoint itself in their homepage. But yeah, there are many other websites which actually give these templates for free.
Okay. And the other question is that how exactly you do zooming of images while presenting a PPT?
Yeah, I'll just share a screen once again, just to show how easy it is. Let's say this is a slide and this is the image which I have. So
this is in keyboard. This is in keyboard, not in PowerPoint. No?
Yeah,
this is in keyboard.
Keynotes. Yeah, this is in
keynote.
Made in keynote.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are similar features in Microsoft PowerPoint as well.
Okay.
So what I do is you have a slide here. You copy paste the same slide again. So now you have one and two. So one you have this one small, and the second one you have a bigger one. You make it big.
Okay.
You make it big, as big as you want, and then make sure that there is this transition. So there is a transition called Magic Move in Keynotes. So when you put this transition, it actually makes it look big. Like if I play this, when I enter, it becomes big.
Okay, so that's fantastic. Thing.
Yeah, so what we do is over here, as in this kind of fundus, we click this slide, make it double. And let's suppose we want to make the disk very enlarged. So we make this enlarged as much as you can to focus only the disk. Okay, so now this is a focus to the disk. And if we want the next slide to make it more imaged, like macula, for the macula to be. So now, and you make sure that this magic move is already there. So now you do play and you can see how it zooms into the disk and it goes to the macula as well.
Okay.
It is that simple.
Very nice. Very nice.
So that's a learning experience for us also.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I just wanted to add one point here, sir. As Prithvi was telling, this magic move, the concept was brought initially by the Apple, and then Microsoft also has introduced this concept, and it's called morph transition.
What's morph, that word?
Morph, M-O-R-P-H, morph transition. So okay. It behaves exactly as magic move. So okay. All of us need to buy MacBook all the time, even though I have MacBook, but I'm still...
There are similar animations, transitions also in Microsoft.
True.
Yeah.
Okay. Then there's one more question Dr. Fatima wants to know that can you please list down various software which are used by the panelists?
For me, I usually use the inbuilt apps, that is Keynote and iMovies, which is already there when you buy a MacBook. And the other softwares which can be used are those which comes in Microsoft Office, that is Microsoft PowerPoint. All these are all the applications which are already there in our computer, but we don't actually explore them. If we start exploring the ones which are already there in the computer, then we can, there are a lot of things which we can do. Just that we need to explore them, explore these softwares. We don't really require another external software to buy any other software. We can actually use these softwares which are already there in the computer, just that we need to explore them.
True. And the answer of the another question that has been sent is that, is this magic move thing can be, is it possible on Microsoft? So you have already told that it is possible, and it is called morph transition. And then Dr. Kata wants to know that what is SW, where available, how much it costs?
What is that?
SW. Maybe software, is it?
Not much idea about
that. Maybe you might have used a abbreviated form of software as SW, maybe. Probably means anyways. So that is something which we had, and we keep getting questions for the initial speakers even later on. So then also we will ask you, and we will keep having more and more information from you. Any other comment from any of our other speakers, panelists? Madam, Dr. Namrata?
Excellent presentation, Prithvi. Like I said, a learning experience for us also. And regarding the software that I use for editing, it is by Adobe only, Pro. Of course, it comes at a price. Only thing is that I'm used to it, and it is quite simple to use. But I think all of them which are available free of cost are also equally good.
Yeah. Cut Pro you use, no?
So I think it is more about an idea rather than this. But I think everything that needed to be covered, Prithvi, is already covered very well.
So now we move on to our next talk. And the next talk is by Dr. Pawan Kumar. And he'll be talking on customizing ophthalmic moving images, that is animations. How to make ophthalmic 2D and 3D animations. That's going to be a real wonderful lecture. So, Dr. Pawan, please.
First of all, I would like to thank Prasanna, Rajesh sir, and Namrata madam for including me in this wonderful session. I hope my screen is visible.
Yes.
So let me start. Okay. So I just want to make it a simple way to create ophthalmic 2D animations so that everybody can start practicing this right from today. So what are animations? So animation is a method in which the figures are manipulated to appear as a moving object. See here in this down, if you can see, a road has appeared and a car has moved. Actually, both are still images. But since we have added animation to this, it appears as though the car is moving in front of us. So previously, all these animations were done in a traditional drawing. Multiple drawing images were done, and then they were photographed and showed in a film. But now we have moved very much forward, where we've got this CGI imagery, where you get multiple different wonderful animations. So what animations has a role to play? So animation makes the concept, which are complex, very simple. So as you can see here, the transmission of COVID can be easily halted if you just move out of the contact. But for us, is animations so simple to make? So as you see in the left side, you can see a 3D video of a surgical case where it shows how the nucleus drops. So these are all wonderful animations, which makes this concepts very simple, very understandable, but that comes at with the cost and also the time. So it is not easy for everybody to create these animations. We need a separate software for that, and it costs lots of money and it takes lots of time. And suppose if we hire a person, if we cannot do this by ourselves because we don't have any knowledge about all these things, we need somebody where we have to keep explaining them each and every step because they're not that ophthalmic personnel. So I just wanted to find a jugaad way to make 2D animations very simple and easy. So there I came across this Microsoft PowerPoint. The last talk, Prithvi has clearly explained, wonderfully explained the keynote and the iMovies. In this talk, I would just like to highlight the important features of Microsoft PowerPoint, which we can be easily used to make 2D animations. So routinely we use Microsoft PowerPoint to make slide presentation. We can insert various text, objects, graphics, and movies, which can be easily shared, printed, displayed. Now, how can Microsoft PowerPoint can come to us to make in 2D animations? So the other users, what we can do is we can customize our own title slides. As Prithvi told, there are various ready-made templates available on the internet. Some comes free, some you have to pay money for that. What we can do is we can, if you know the software a little bit more, we can customize our own title slides. We can give movie intros, like when we are making movies, we can give various intros by creating all these animations in the MS PowerPoint. We can add various animation to the text. We can do custom drawing. We can add 2D animations. We can insert 3D objects, and we can convert all these into movies. So if you can see, this Microsoft comes with a drawing option. Then we have this transition effect, and then we have this various animations effect. So how do we make this title slide? I'll just give few examples. See, in this talk, we just wanted to tell how do you achieve three results with single surgery. That is, in case of phacotropectomy, there is a raised IOP, angle closure, and significant cataract. So I want to make sure this in a simple way. So we just shot an arrow where three fruits can be easily fall. So this is an intro slide or a title slide, which can be easily done with Microsoft PowerPoint, where we just have to add various animations. As you can see in the animation pane, we have this multiple animations added, which I'll explain a little bit in the next slide. So all these animations can be added and synchronized together to make it more appealing and convincing. So another example, which says, like, I just wanted to highlight a ClickArt 3D exhibition. We just made this exhibition and then made a movie on this. As you see, each and every text is moving in a different way and appearing as though there is a 3D appearance is happening. So this can be easily created with the Microsoft PowerPoint. This is one of the video intro I made with the Microsoft PowerPoint, where the title was Mission Impossible. So as all of us know, in the Mission Impossible movie series, the first scene is always, the title will come like this. So I just wanted to imitate that. So in that, I created this in the Microsoft PowerPoint. So this can be easily made with the PowerPoint. Only thing is we just have to know all this text and then various animations to be added, and we have to synchronize it in a similar way. That's all. So I'll just show you an example. As you can see, I just wanted to make it more simple so that if I keep on telling complex things, it may not be, time may be a constraint. If you can see that there are two texts here, and I just want to make this as an intro slide, the same topic as what I'm talking. So we have various animations available here. There are basically, we can classify into three types. This is the entrance animation. So entrance is how the text should appear in the slide in the beginning. That is the entrance animation, where you can see various animations are there. If you just click it, you can see how it appears. So this is an entrance animation. Then comes emphasis animation. Emphasis is once this the text has appeared in the slide, then how is it going to behave? So we can just increase the size of it. We can zoom it. Then once we do add this, we can even change this effect option by going towards the right side. We have this effect option where we can see that when this animation is applied, the text is going to zoom to 150%. Since 150% is too much for the slide, we can customize it. We can make it to 120%, so which can be ideal. I can customize
the slide it. Stuck?
We can't see anything.
Is the slide stuck, I think, because...
Okay, sir.
See it moving.
Effects are not showing. It's just a...
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. I'll just start from the beginning. One second. Now, are you able to see my screen, madam?
Yeah, we can see.
Yeah. So, I just start from the beginning. So, this is a simple text slide where I just wanted to show how to add animations, various animations. we have three different types of animations which are inbuilt in the PowerPoint. The first one is an entrance animation, which is highlighted in green color, where we can add all these animations so that we can know how the slide, the title appears first. Then once it comes, we can even emphasize it. We can add another animation, that is emphasizing animation. Once it has come, then we can increase or emphasize it. We can just increase the size of it. As you can see, it is zoomed out here. Then we can see is 150%. We can see this effect option. This tab can be opened by clicking this animation pane. So when we click this animation pane, we can see this properties option where we can go for effect option. In this effect option, we can see the text is zooming to 150%. We can just customize it or we can adjust whatever inbuilt. 150 is too much for this slide, so I can reduce it to 120% so that it fits the slide. Then once it is done, we can just go for exit animation. So exit is how it goes out of the slide. So this is animation called flyout, where we can change the direction of it also. So that is going down, we can make it to go up. So bottom or right side. So this effect option also will come. So all these animations are added to this single text where you can see 1, 2, 3. So this is indicates what was the first animation, that is the it comes, then it got emphasized, then it exits. Now we can combine this by going it here in an option called start. So this we can, there are three options here where we can combine this animation together. We can make it all with the previous, or we can make the animation to come one after the other, or we can come one after one animation is finished, the other animation come. So all these are simple animations. There is one more extra benefit what we get is a path animation. So path animation is where we can create a path for an object or a text to move. Suppose if I add just this line option, I can this line, so we can make the object or the text to move in the intended direction what we want. So these all things can be added, which can be modified, and it can be synchronized also. So this is how we can make a title slide, and also this can also be used to create the object animations also. So going back to my original presentations, so that was how we make the title slide. One second. I think it is just answer. I just stop and I'll again start. Yeah. So these are the various, it is now seen, sir?
Yeah.
This is how variously we make. So we can even make hidden objects come out of as you've seen in this slide. So this is one of the title slide I made, where lessons learned during pandemic, where we wanted to say, can we Uber as I care? So as you see in this animation, the scooter was coming from nowhere. See, as you see, the line is there, then another object is falling from there, it is coming. So it is not coming from the behind. So this all can be done. The simple way is we can just add one text box, one rectangular shape box here, and then this image will go behind it. So when we start, it will come behind this so that it appears as though it is coming from nowhere. So this all can be done easily with the PowerPoint. We can add various text animation as I showed. It can also, like as you see, this appears like a card which is coming and opening, and we can add various shadows to it to make it more 3D appealing. And in this slide, we can say that we can use the animations to compare what was the OPD in Base Hospital Vision Center. As you see, when I click first time, I can see that only 24% of the OPD was improved in 2019, whereas in Vision Center, it has increased to 66%. So this slide can be made easily with the PowerPoint with various animations. So we can even do custom drawing. As you see in this, this is one infographic which we get in the internet, whereas we can make this easily with our PowerPoint. So we can add multiple shapes, which is given inside the PowerPoint. We can combine this together. We can combine this together and make a similar infographic, and we can even make a custom drawing as per our wish. So similarly, we can draw this, all this custom drawing. Sir, give me a minute, sir. I'll just be back, sir. My son is crying. I'll just come be a back.
I think that was an excellent presentation, and we will continue again. Although he's shown it so simply, but I'm sure there is some learning curve to it, and it's not that easy. What do you tip?
There is some noise in the background. Admin, can you just check?
Yeah, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. As rightly pointed out, actually, I started learning how to make animations when I was in my undergraduation, and my innovations started with animation. So how can we make, so the moving images is what I would like to call it, because that sounded more, how to make an image moving is always what I really see my vision as. So making an image moving, as even Prithvi showed with the magic move, though it seems effortless, actually there is some learning. I think the scenario that we are here for the future, more workshops where we can have people like the TSTC that we have. So sir, am I audible?
Yeah, probably some instability in the internet.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So animation making has its own learning curve. I would say at least minimum 3 years is what it is. It took me at least 2 to 3 years to get a hands on as to what it is. And then from there onwards, we will just keep evolving, sir. It is just a matter of those initial 2 years or 3 years, which is more difficult. And from there onwards, we'll start to learn more tools and more effects and more transitions.
True. So
I'm sorry for the interruption.
Okay. So Pavan, can we continue now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We took a question in between. So
yeah.
Okay. So as I said before, so we can use this custom drawing to create our own. Use this images to add more animations. So as you see here, so this is the one which I drawn with the use of PowerPoint by adding various shapes. So we can draw the way whatever we want. So this can be done with the combining of all the shapes together, and then we can add 2D animations to it. So in this, as I Prithvi told, the magic move, the same animation which is there in the PowerPoint, so which is the morph animation, the same which has been added here. As you can see, the image is moving so smoothly. So one slide to another slide, I've added this morph transition. So that makes the movement very smooth, and it is very appealing for the audience. As you see, when we are dissecting the sclera, we need the heel of the crescent bed to be up. Whereas when you are dissecting the cornea, the heel should be down. So this can be easily represented by making these animations. So a premature entry, where if you don't turn the crescent blade, then if you turn too much, it can cause corneal button holding. So this can all simple animations, which makes our concept very easier and that everybody to understand, that can be done very easily with the PowerPoint. So as you see, this one, I just wanted to bring a concept that mix is coming to India. So this can be made like, look like a 3D image, even in PowerPoint also. So here, what I've done is all these clouds are custom drawn, and this image of the plane, I've taken it from the internet. What I've just adjusted is this one of the image will be behind this plane, and this will be ahead of the plane. We have that option of, if you just select the image, if you just go click it, we can see send to back, bring to front option. So this option, we can use it to make it to look like a 3D. That can be easily done with a PowerPoint.
I think it is also more about the idea. I mean, to get an idea to do it, and then of course it is also technology and the way you do it. Yes. But Pavan, it's more about the idea that the way the plane is coming onto India.
And one beautiful feature what PowerPoint has recently brought is inserting a 3D model. So there are various 3D models we can insert. We can just go here, and there is an option called 3D models. We can just click it, so we can get various 3D option. 3D model comes there. We can search it, and we can just insert it. And once it is inserted, we can use the various options. We can use it like a 3D. This is yet. There are many features are available. For I, it takes more time to come. So this option is also there. We can use it for a general presentation. And then once it is done, as Prithvi told, we can export it to movies easily. And what I can suggest is we can use this learning resources, which is there in the YouTube. I have a channel called Presentation Process from Dr. Ram Gopal and PowerPoint School by Aman. So this teaches the PowerPoint features very easily and a simple way, where I also learned from it. So I would like to say thank you for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, Pavan. It was really wonderful, and I would say a lot of appreciations have come from, you know, many of the ophthalmologists, young ophthalmologists like Sonal Kalia and many senior people also, that this is a wonderful thing, a totally new concept of a webinar, and they are really happy with your presentations. Definitely, it's not an easy thing to do, but very easy to say, but difficult to do. And it takes a lot of time, as Prasanna was telling, that it takes at least 2 to 3 years to actually get into the groove. But yes, little bit of understanding and little bit of, modification in presentation can make it more, more impressive. There's one question for you from one of the... Where do you get the 3D models from? Like you said that we get a 3D model. So where do you get it from?
There are few, as I told, in the Microsoft only, we can insert 3D models which are inbuilt. Or we can also...
Yeah,
Bhavan, I can take the question. Sorry, my son is actually...
Yeah, you can. We'll chip in for you.
Thank you.
Sir, the way the 2D and 3D can be shown, the display that we are doing is actually on a two-dimensional plane. There are so many trick shots that we can use to show a two-dimensional image in a three-dimensional way. So that's the maximum. If you go, as in the internet, as he was showing a particular website, like how Prithvi was taking a template, there are so many things that we just need to Google it, and you get 3D models shown in a 2D plane, which is very easily available. They're all free of cost. There is no, as of such, I just Google it, sir. If you Google it, you get a lot of 3D models. Some may be watermarked by the ones who are actually creating it, but many of it may not be watermarked also. But coming to the real thing would be is when we are going for a competitive video competition, or especially the work that we want to be presented as original, we can also create our own 3D models. That will be another way forward. An innovative surgical technique or something that we do, it is better for us to create our own 3D model so that we don't get plagiarized, especially when we are targeting an competitions, a prestigious All India competition or an international competition. Mostly these videos are more towards, even the YouTubes that we are going to upload, the restrictions are more increasing nowadays, sir. 10 years back, we used to make short films with the audios from other films from Hollywood or so. But now the same video that I uploaded 10 years back, the audio alone is muted by the copyright infringement. So whatever the content that we make, it is always better to make it original, because even last week when we talked about uploading it in YouTube, YouTube's copyrights have become more stricter, that the owner should not have a copyright infringement on us, and a good video may actually get removed by the channel. So I think, for presentation, we can still take others' 3D models. The future is to it's not a do-it-yourself, but creating your own 3D model would be the way forward also. Yeah, Pawan, I think you can also add on to if I missed something.
Yes, sir. Yes, I totally agree. So what we can do is, as I told you, we can do a custom drawing by our own. Simple images. We can just see in the internet. We can just copy it with the PowerPoint. We don't have to buy from them. Even the simple plane, simple rocket, or simple face animations, we can simply make it with the PowerPoint. You just have to learn it a little more. That's all. So that's easier. And yes, better to be original. True. But there are few music or images which are copyright free. So one example is Pixabay.com. So if you go to Pixabay.com, where you get multiple vector images or images which are copyright free. So we just have to mention that it's taken from Pixabay. That's all. So they don't do any problem. And even in YouTube, we can just go royalty free music or royalty free video, where you get all these things which are not copyright claimable. So that's easier.
There is one another question. There are a couple of similar questions actually, that which PowerPoint model is latest and all that. Dr. Kata wants to know that. And the other question is by Dr. Dhawal, who wants to know that how can we get Microsoft Office plus PowerPoint plus Word? Well, that is a different thing. You need to have a software. Is it true that individual app is available and can be downloaded? Do you recommend original MS Office or free version?
Yes, sir. So Microsoft Office, initially it used to be very costlier, but I'll tell you, it is actually cheaper. You can buy it on Amazon itself or Flipkart itself. There are various other places where in the online you can buy it for more cheaper price. You can just go search for Microsoft Office for lower cost, you can available. So the latest one is 2019 one. They say 2021 is coming, but latest is the 2019. In Microsoft also, there are various versions. One is Microsoft Office 365, Microsoft Office Pro. All those things are there. But any Microsoft Office after 2016 is very good. So all these what animations I've made is after 2016. And 2016 is really a good version. And you can just go and search in Amazon or Flipkart. You can get one lifetime, one PC, maybe 3,000, 4,000. Yes, it's available.
Dr. Pallavi wants to know that, can we use 3D Paint from Microsoft for creating 3D models?
3D Paint, yes, we can do it. But I have not tried it before. But 3D, we have to again go for a 3D. That rotation on option is a shape format. We have to add the 3D effect by the shadowing, by the color hue and all those things we can do, but Microsoft is not the right software for us.
Okay. So we move on to our next speaker and we'll keep discussing in between. So we have Dr. Shruti, who will be talking on my latest image editing apps and software tools, how to not lose pixels while editing. And she will be also talking about the green mat users, how to create in the slide experience, speaker present, inside PPT content, etc. So let's hand over.
Yes, sir.
He will be telling us all about these things.
I would like to thank the Indian Society of Cornea and Keratoconus Refractive Surgeon, as well as Dr. Prasanna, for making me a part of this academic platform. It is such a honor to be among such prolific speakers. So without delay, let me just start on with my first topic. So the first one would be, what are the latest imaging tools and apps that we use, and how not to lose pixels? Because we all worry that we have such a good clinical photograph, but then by the time it's done with all the processing and everything, it comes back with so much pixels, it doesn't look as appealing as we want it to be. So our team has a motto that a picture can speak 1,000 words more than anything else. I think Prithvi sir was also telling, you know, speak a lot through images whenever possible. So why does image editing and representation matters? Here you can see this wonderful gonioscopy image, which we had made it in a unique way. We have seen multiple images of gonioscopy online, clinical images, but that we were not satisfied with that representation. We wanted it to look more in a sort of a kaleidoscopic way, more geometric. And that's where when we were playing with a lot of tools and softwares, we were able to do this in a very easy, and it hardly took us like maybe a minute or two to get this done. But definitely the process behind it is a huge one. So let me go through it in a step-by-step way. So the first thing I would say, it starts with image acquisition, because if you do not have a really good quality image, or at least a moderate quality one, you're not going to be able to bring it out the way you want. So make sure that you have a good image acquisition model. At least it need not be very complex. A basic for a slit lamp, it's a basic adapter with a good Android or an iOS device to capture it. And you just need a basic fundus camera. Once you have all that, you know, image acquisition is pretty easy. Then build your style. As I was saying, this gonioscope image is something that was unique for us. So we built our style, not just in this, in multiple ways for each publication, for each photography competition. We had a unique style for us. We made sure that it told its story on its own. It didn't need anything else. And every small thing matters. As previously they were talking about the PowerPoint and the iMovies and every part of the presentation, even the small aspects like, you know, color, saturation, brightness, contrast, definition, every small changes matter. So do not hesitate to do those changes while editing your image. And collage making, it's definitely an art, because, you know, you can't just put a random collage with jumbled up images, and you need the proper orientation, the proper layout, and every important as it's as important as the image itself. So first thing, as I was saying, image acquisition. So that's how we do it. We never just take a photograph. Every image acquisition is in the form of a videograph, other than the retinal images. So we make sure that we acquire a high quality image through the best camera, whoever in the, amongst our colleagues, whoever has the best camera possible. We take that, use it on the slit lamp adapter. We take at least a minute or two video, because we know if it's just a photograph, we might miss a particular detail. There might be a mild defocus and the patient might have just moved their eyes. So we make sure from the point in which we start examining the patient, it is in the form of videograph. And in my iOS device, I make sure I make it HD and I increase the frame rate so that I get the best possible outcome. And later on, I can just pause in the videos and take screenshots of the data which is required. So considering this patient, the end data which I had acquired was this. So we had, we had multimodal imaging, which is OCT and Sheenflex photograph. This was one of our award-winning images in IARSA. So you can see the entire appeal of the image, the way it is arranged, the way it was captured and way it was edited. And finally, the collage of it and how it was shown in the end. So then we have this, just a sec. So I have this POTO. This is an app which I have been using for the past 3 years, which is free in iOS. And it is very user friendly. And it does not reduce the quality of your image in any way. So you can just transfer your images to your iPhone. And from there, you can just collage the images, whatever number of images you need. And so far, for almost 99% of my publications, as well as for the photography competitions, this is the only app that I have used so far. It's very user-friendly. So I'm just going to show an example of how... So example of how I went about it. So the moment you open this app, it has the collage maker in it, and you just go to the gallery immediately. Over there, you choose all the photos that you want to be collaged together. So these are the four photos which I'm choosing. And once that is done, just choose a random layout. And over there, the lower section, you can see that has something known as the layout. You click that. It has endless possibilities. It can be square. It can be a rectangle. It can be horizontally oriented or vertically oriented, and even within that, it has various layouts ready made for you to do it. You don't need to arrange it and then, you know, resize it and everything. It's just ready made available, which you have to choose. So for this particular image, I'm just cruising through it, and I decide on going with this particular layout. Now this is my primary image. So what I do, I just need to long press, drag and drop it, and it just exchanges that image. And once primary image has been done, I now go to the secondary images. Again, you can see it's very easy to just resize the images. It's all like pinch and zoom and nothing else to do with that. And once that is done, you can see I have almost arranged my secondary images. I just need to zoom in on the infrared image, which is zoomed in. And finally, it's all done. Now I'm moving on to the margins and the inter-image zones. So I need it all to be uniform. It should not be too thick or too thin. I just have a particular, I always use 2 to 3. And when I go for the inter image, it's like 10 or 11. And then finally, I choose the color, because sometimes we need a white one, sometimes it's a black one, depending on the overall images. So the black is there, it is not, it doesn't look that good or appealing. So I go back to the white. So, and then that's it. You just save the image. It has really good quality. There is no pixel breakage. And when you're, again, you can just mail it back to your computer and use it for further use. Similarly, for the gonioscopy, as I was saying, so I choose the 4 gonioscope image. These were all acquired through videos, so not photographs, so screenshot of videos. Again, I go to the layout. As I was showing, the different layouts possible. So imagine the number of total permutation and combinations in which you can actually collage an image. And finally, I choose the 1:1 ratio. And over there, I go for this sort of a kaleidoscopic appearance. And again, I just arrange the images so that the inferior angle, the nasal, superior, everything comes up appropriately. And once that is done, so you can see it's pretty easy. It hardly takes me a few seconds. And once that is done, I just resize. You can rotate the image. You can zoom in, zoom out. Just align it according to the anatomical landmarks so that it all looks neat in the end. And these all videos were basically done with an iMovie app. So as Prithvi sir was telling, it's very user-friendly. So just I screen recorded these videos from my phone and transferred it to the iMovies and got it done. And the end product, as you can see, it's a very beautiful image. So once that is done, that's what I was saying, organizing the collage. And collage only the images which are needed, because I know there are a lot of restrictions, the number of images per article. So we have so much clinical data. We want to put all the images together. Do not do that. Only pick up the necessary images and collage them. And before collaging, edit each and every image separately. Only when you have the final quality of image in your hand, use it for collage. Because after collaging, if you try to edit it, the other images are going to lose their appeal. So that's very important aspect that you need to remember. So this is something how we tell our story. So you see, this is a basic collage. You can see it's just right eye, left eye, PI is done. There's a hyphema. Then you can see we did the gonioscopy with open angles, which was again depicted, which in itself is a collage. And then you can see finally that there was a dilated fundus evaluation. So that's the story of an acute angle closure patient. Then comes the annotation of images, which is as important as the image itself, because I have the image ready, but where do I want my audience to focus at? In that case, use very particular annotations, and I put it across in a very neat way. It should not be haphazard, it should all be organized. So I'm just focusing on a very subclinical serous RD over here with in various cross sections of the retina, which is very important for that particular case. And you can see we can use circles, arrows, asterisks, but as I was saying, have a uniform color code for it. And even when arranging it, make sure it's all arranged in a uniform way and not in a scattered way as much as possible, depending on the data. And when not necessary, avoid annotation. So in this image, you can see that with the slit lamp photograph, it's just an ectropion UVA. I'm not going to put any arrows over it to show what the ectropion UVA is, very obvious. Same way for the gonioscopy, it's normal. I have nothing to annotate that. The only region annotation was required was for the sheen flake image showing the tissue of the ectropion UVA. So that's it, as simple as that. And then coming the follow-up images. We all mostly have clinical data with follow-up images. Whenever you're acquiring the data, make sure that you're acquiring it at the same spot in which you acquired previously, the pathology where it had happened, as much as possible, whenever it's necessary. So following which, when you're arranging those images also, make sure they are aligned. So that when the person has a final look at the image which you have collaged together for follow-up, it all falls into the same plane and same way, the arrowing, everything, same size, same colors, do not change that. And one important thing is most often we notice that people have wonderful images. Sometimes the montage software is not available within the system. In that cases, you have all the quadrant photographs. This is a FFA in the almost the late phase. So in that case, you can use the Adobe Photoshop. Just select the images that you want and put them into various layers. And once that is done, you just need to select the central circle, remove the outside all the black areas from the film, and then use it as reduce the transparency and use it as sort of a stencil so that you can superimpose one on top of the other using the retinal blood vessels. And similar way, each and every image, as you keep doing, you will start seeing the final image, which is almost like a beautiful wide field photograph. And this will give you the end point of the image. And again, as I said, work on the brightness and contrast. You're going to have a beautiful image. And the final tool that we use for our images that we have recently started using is the Deep Image AI system, which upscales our image, nothing else, but it's just a sort of an upscaling and enhancing. You will see the effects of it. So this is a sort of, it's a paid app which is available online. There are a few free apps also available, but after trying out a lot of apps, this was the best for our team. So this was actually a 20 degree photograph of the optic nerve head FFA with false color. And we thought, okay, this looked really good. But then what was nagging at the back of our mind was sort of these breakages here and there. So when we were able to upscale the image, this is what we got, which was, it almost looked like, you know, like molten gold and so perfect with not much of breakage anywhere, maintaining the clinical data. It just enhances and upscales it, removing all the artifacts. So keeping that in mind, this is also another image which was upscaled. And finally, you can see, even after upscaling, I had tinkered with the color and saturation. And I made sure this is the only thing I wanted the person to see, not the entire aspect of it. So I just cut out the part which I needed to focus on, leaving away the rest of the retina. So that's how we tell our story. And even for a publication, this was one of our initial publications, which was letter to editor, but we wanted to make sure that we told our story through images. So you can see that we had actually used 11 figures for this short communication. We could have easily, you know, collaged a lot of images together, but that would have been very confusing and would not have been the point which we wanted to make. So overall, it was a total of 11 images with a good collage, a good ordering. And as I was telling, it was, we were able to tell our story the way it wanted to be. It was meant to be said. So the end point, as I was saying, you know, you need to bring out a good award-winning photograph. So these are the, some of our award-winning photographs for ASCRS 2022. And these were all the multimodal images which won some awards in the IARSA 2021 Chennai. And some of our cover photos recently, which were published. And this is one image which won for the AAOS 2020. Thank you so much. And I would also like to thank our team, which is all a team effort, which when we work on images and videos together. And I hope it was very simple, but hope I was, it was a useful aspect of the presentation. So should I go with the next presentation, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, I'll finish it off.
Go ahead, Shruti. You are make everything look simple, and I'm sure a lot of effort has gone into it to make it so simple. And you are so dexterous with it. I don't know for us how much time will it take to, you know, learn this.
So it's very easy, ma'am. I think it's just 2 to 3 days, and you'll be expert with it. Yeah.
It is said that things which look very simple in the hands of experts, they, you know, in order to make them look so simple, a lot of hard work is done, you know, behind the scenes. That is very true. Sir. Please go ahead. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So my second topic is green mat user. And unfortunately, I'm not able to use the green mat today because I'll tell you about the difficulties of it as well as the advantages of it, definitely. So we know that after the COVID, it has become an era of webinars, even though the restrictions have lifted, because there are various advantages to webinars. It has brought all the information to our fingertips. Previously, if we needed to learn a new technique or, you know, about some new technology, we had to travel all the way to some international conference or a national conference, and only that way do we learn something. But now with these webinars at hand, everyone is benefiting a lot from it. So it's going to stay, and it's not leaving us anytime soon. But we all know, as ophthalmologists, definitely astenopia and you're bored, and there are easy distractions. We just have to minimize our screen. We go look at YouTube videos, and we have a lot of Amazon shopping done during that time, the best time to do it. You know, mails, definitely the best time to get our mail in order. A lot of social media distractions. And another effect that was people were able to assess is the offline effect. Even though right now we, like 6-7 people are interacting and it is an online part, the person on the other end who's listening to it, there is a high chance that they might feel it like an offline effect where it's just a recorded video playing for them. They might get detached from the entire group. So that's always a possibility. So how do we overcome it? One such effort towards it is the green mat. And definitely it will help us be very more dynamic for the speaker as well as the participant. So the software which we use is the Open Broadcaster software, which is freely downloadable for all. And it is one of the softwares used for a green mat presentation. I'm going to go step by step now on how to use this software in your device. So first thing is, Once you open the software, this is the screen that you're going to see. And in that, you're going to have this pop-up box. So you just press the plus button. It's going to have all the settings that you're going to need to do before you start your green mat presentation. So once that is done, so I'm just highlighting that. That is done. The first part over here is you set your audio capture, because we all know for any sort of presentation, it's about the audio and video and the PowerPoint. So all three now we have to input into the GreenMat software. So first thing, the audio input capture. So make sure which you're going to use, your microphone or your headphones or whatever it is that you're going to do. Make sure it is provided over there. And then you go for the video capture device. So video capture device is going to be our computer camera, our PC camera or a computer camera. And then the chroma key, very important setup. Sometimes people use a green mat at the back or it's a blue mat. Whatever it is, you choose the chroma key and you choose the color in which it's, the color in which you're going to have your mat behind you. So we choose green and hopefully it's visible. So following which, next is the window capture. And inside this window capture only, you're going to put in your PowerPoint slide. So you have the PowerPoint slide simultaneously opened up in your PC. And then you input that into your window capture setting. Following which, you go to the virtual cam setting. So virtual cam setting can be seen here. And once that is done, now the virtual cam is the one in which you are going to be standing inside the PowerPoint presentation, wherever you are. So it can be of various sizes. It does not need to be just small. You can even stand inside your entire presentation. You can walk around inside it. It can all be done in various ways. As I was saying, it can whichever place you feel like, you feel the best for that presentation, you can put yourself into the presentation over there. And finally, when you're starting your Zoom presentation, very important, do not share your screen. This is just directly in the video aspect of it. You go to the OBS virtual camera and immediately your presentation is going to be in your background in the green mat. And initially when we started out, it was something of a very, you can see the structure that we have built there out of a chair. It was very innovative aspect of ours. So we had the green mat behind, and then it was, you can see that there is a PC over here, there's a computer over here, and there is a small phone over here. So what is going on over here is that the speaker cannot see his presentation in the PC. It is actually being relayed in the computer. But for the speaker to know where he is at in the presentation, he's using this mobile phone, which is basically relaying the Zoom meeting back to him. So he's just seeing where he is at times and adjusting himself to accordingly to the relay. And so this was our update. So once initially it was something like this, but later on we were able to update to a very more methodical way. So you can see that the screen displaying the sides were present in front of the speaker, and the PC which was relaying the presentation, presenter onto the presentation was just present a bit below. So a speaker was also having the comfort of looking at the presentation at the same time. So one of the difficulties even right now, I'm pretty sure people are facing, is that we have all these speakers which keep dropping down and some data will get covered. And even if we keep moving our speakers video to other sides of the presentation, it keeps happening. Some or the other data gets covered. And if we just reduce the speaker's video out of the presentation, it's more of looking at a video rather than a seminar. So in that aspect, we can the advantage is movement within the frame. So even if the speaker in the green mat is covering aspect of the presentation, they just have to move out of it, and immediately the data which they want to show is very much visible for the audience. And only one thing that you have to be aware of: do not wear anything green or blue, or you're going to end up as a floating head. I'm pretty sure we would have seen all this, not right now, maybe in a very previous weather report channels, because they are the ones who use the green mat. So advantages of green mat, as I was saying, yes, it is a highly interactive experience, both for the speaker as well as the audience. Because trust me, as a speaker, I think we'll also feel more dynamic when we are doing that, and more clarity of the presentation and creativity. You can definitely play around with it. You can do a lot with, I'm pretty sure with all the animations that the previous speakers have talked about, using that, this would make a very good tool. But the only disadvantage, you need the particular setup when you're going to do this green mat presentation. Thank you so much, and I thank the team.
Thank you, Shruti. It was really fantastic. Wonderful presentation. Both the presentations.
Thank you, sir.
Good. And you
thank you, sir. Thank you.
Pointed out the use of this green mat presentation and how it evolved during this COVID pandemic. Any comment yes, from the panelists? We have a few questions for you, but before that, Prasanna, any comment on that?
Prasanna, you're muted.
You have to unmute now. Me and Shruti are together. We are at Trichy, and she incidentally happened to be my sister also. We do innovate together, sir. So she's part of my research team, and we started the moving images a long time back. And even in AOS, which happened fully virtual, all the presentations that we gave in AOS, we made sure we used the green mat. So all these were the pictures that we did not just take for the presentation. We actually, all the video recordings that are available in YouTube now. So we use the green mat to show the markings where we really wanted the speakers to. So it's something called the YouTubers, content creators used to do that. So they used to have a mic and they used to have a green mat. And even now today, online teachers are also doing that, sir. So whatever we want them to focus on, any particular step in a surgery or any particular parameter that we want them to focus on. And that is one thing. And also the pointed out by Shruti rightly, the photo editing. So whatever that competitive things that even for publishing, the journals are very particular that they want a high definition images nowadays. So anything that goes scientific with good imaging, not only the camera matters, also the pre-production and the post-production. The pre-production is that one that we plan while taking a photograph, that this is how we want the lighting to be, this is how we want the slit to be adjusted. The post-production is what Shruti was talking about. How, after the image has been acquired, how are we going to make it more palatable? And as she pointed out, we are humbled and honored to share that in ACRS, we both together, we shared 8 awards in the photography, the recently concluded ACRS last week.
Oh,
even wow. The IRSA, we shared together 7 awards. So she's one of our intelligent team members of
excellent.
Team effort. But Shruti is the one. We have formed our own moving center of moving image department. I'll take you through that after some time. So that's Shruti wonderful. Is one of the main persons of my team, and I think the session is open to Madam and Sir for questions.
We have a few questions for you, Shruti. The questions from people who are listening to you and watching you. They want to know whether there's any drop in image quality if you take snapshots from the videos.
No, sir. No, definitely not, sir. Because that's what I have been doing for 3 years now, since the time we started our journey towards this photographies. And it's very easy, sir. Because even in iOS devices, even as you're taking videos, you can capture screenshots, live photos as we are taking videos. And the moment you are done, even on your phone, you just press the screenshot. The quality of the image is as clear as the one in the video, sir. There is no problem with that.
I think you use most of these images for publications also, and you had concerns over there, because I think Rajesh would remember that when we used to have those cameras, we used to, you know, now of course we have very good cameras, but we didn't have good ones. We used to fiddle with the images.
Mm-hmm. And the only point with the photograph is we would want to have a particular frame, but to that time, the patient may have a blink of the eye, or he may tilt his head. So at that time, ours is a very high volume center, ma'am. Like, we'll have to make sure we can't wait the patient in slit lamp for a longer time.
Yeah.
So as well as even for trainees, they would also allow to take a photograph, but they would also want to dispose the patient maybe 5 to 10 minutes or so. So that will also be running in their mind, because the sisters will be having the next patient ready and so much of things will be going on. We'll have to get our scientific data right. By taking a video, we'll save a lot of time. We'll take 1 minute of video. There will be blinks. There will be some head tilts. But then after the end of the day, we'll go back. We'll get the data. And then we can sit and analyze what best we can have. Or sometimes when we take a photo, that itself, we'll know that we can't use this image for a scientific photo data. Okay. That is the one thing that practically I have, and we both have faced together in our opinion.
There's one question by Dr. Vigya. And He wants to know that which iOS phone do you use for taking the clinical photos and videos?
So we use 12 Pro Max. Sir. So as of now, it's 12 Pro Max we are using. We are planning on upgrading later on. Because we believe for clinical, we are very focused on the imaging aspect of the clinical data. So we believe so the best, whichever is possible. And whenever that phone is maybe occupied or something, whichever phone is available. But I always tell my fellows that make it a point to do it as a video. Please do not bring me photos, because most often than not, the photos, there will be some black point, white point, and a lot of rainbow colors over it, which cannot be used for publication or any sort of photography competition. So here the only point is taking a video, sir, no matter how big it is.
That's a wonderful idea. Wonderful. So thank you, Shruti. We move on now.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Prasanna, who will be talking about launching the augmented reality ophthalmic platform, 3D gamification, pedagogy, and simulations. Wonderful. And he will also be talking about ophthalmic 4D holograms are finally here. And a couple of things that definitely is it is difficult to understand.
So I think we'll understand better after his
presentation. This is definitely not do it yourself, sir. I should say that before I start, because all the other three speakers definitely had a do it yourself element, though it's a single year learning curve or a 3 year learning curve. But I'll try to put it in a do it yourself template, but it has its own learning curve. And so before I start, may I just add on to one of the videos that me and Shruti took together. So today in the internet, YAG PI is a very common procedure, but if you go and browse in YouTube, you won't find a YAG PI video that often. It's something which is quite very neglected. When we had a literature search for YAG PI, there are very few videos that have shown how the PI was done. So this is one of the videos that we both took together. I'm just sharing it for a completion point. So this is shot in Shruti's phone. So how did we go about this was? So I was seeing it through one of my headsets, because it's very difficult for you to put the adapter and take a YAG PI. And the patient has to be counseled and he has to be told that we are going to take the imaging. So Shruti was sitting next to me and I was doing the procedure through uniocular, and we had the camera fitted with a 3D printed device and she was holding the camera. And this is one of the rare videos that we have also uploaded in YouTube. You can see first the Van Erichs was demonstrated, and then we showed where the beam has to be focused on the crypt here. So we are now focusing and showing where are the crypts, and then we are firing. So with the good camera, we can even see the photo disruption, sir, the blue spark that comes. So with a good camera, you can see even the photo disruption that happens and how the gush of aqueous happens. And then the deepening of the chamber also, all this live we can appreciate. So now you saw that zoom that we did. We just made sure we'll have to show the zoom also, so that the gush of aqueous, how it comes forward, and even the mild micro hyphema, the bleed that happens to the PA that was done. So as I'm just adding on to what she told, so the additional shot. So even if you want to deliver an additional shot, where it has to be done, because sometimes when we teach our fellows that this is where you need to place an additional shot, it's very clueless, because we'll be telling something, but he'll be ending up putting an additional shot in a completely different plane. So you can see that we tell him that this is a red dot here. You just focus it at this point. So it is more useful for teaching also. And now the additional shot is done. And again, how the gush of aqueous comes. So we always believe in moving images, sir. As Shruti was adding, I'm just going to add on to the moving image part of it. So I just wanted to show this YAG PI video of ours. Sir and ma'am will also be knowing that in the literature, there are very few YAG PI videos, because it's very complex to orchestrate and take a YAG PI. So we did almost two patients, one with the Abraham lens, another without. I'm just forwarding
the video. Without the lens.
Yeah, without the lens. So for teaching.
Actually, if I remember correctly, sir, these videos alone took us 3 GB of data on my phone.
Yeah.
So initially when we were taking, because it was all taken in HD with the frame rate was so high, because we wanted to capture the photo disruption. That's the amount of, that's what we need to actually provide for a good quality data.
If we give this much of zoom, the mentees understand that what do we really mean by a crypt. So this is what we really mean by a crypt. and the photo disruption. This is another video showing how the blue light, because photo disruption is something that no one has really seen, because they have heard us, but how does it really visually look? How does the blue spark comes? How does the ions go and generates the energy and splits the iris in that region? So again, as Prithvi was showing, as Pawan was showing, we show it in a slow motion, a zoom view. I'm just showing it once again. So this is what really a photo disruption looks. So the teaching is made more gamified, a gamified or fun learning. They don't need to mug up the concepts is what we try to emphasize on. So that teaching is more of more of a fun one. So
zooming was done while filming it, or you have zoomed it later and then shown?
Filming it one video. When we did the first one, we were not really sure as to how it's going to go, because the parameters were, one was the person who's going to perform the YAG PA and the person who's going to take it and the patient, all of us has to be synced. So once we get an idea that the patient is also in sync with us, for those patients, we can do the other eye also in that way. Because if it's an apprehensive patient, then it's better that we don't even attempt to take a photography or a videography in the other eye. Just get the procedure done with after informing the patient for consent and everything. So, yes, sir. So, yes, sir. I'll move to my talk. So it's just an amalgamation or a connection of all the three that we have done. And the launching the augmented reality, and more, I would say, how we brought the center of moving images. So as Shruti was telling, an image speaks 1,000 words. My vision and mission was, what if we make the image moving? Will we be able to generate more than 1,000 words? So that is what led us to all these 6 innovations that I'll be discussing in the next few minutes. For myself, cognitive thinking really mattered. Cognitive thinking for me, when I was in my MBBS days or in my MS days, when I saw a 2D representation of a 3D, for me, it was very difficult to catch the essence of the concept. When I saw the 3-dimensional representation of something, I was very happy. I felt I nearly knew what it was. And for me, the idea was always to go 4D. Why not? How can we engage our tactile sensation into it so that we can engage a dimensional way, that is a 3D to a 4D. So I welcome you all to the 4-dimensional ophthalmic metaverse, as how myself and Shruti, we both have coined it together as such. And we have also filed the patent, and it happened so on 24th of February, 2022. So this is the patent screenshot that I'm sharing with you under the Mahatma Center of Moving Images Private Limited. We have filed our provisional patent, and 12 months from now, we'll be filing our complete patent as well. So these are the 6 innovations that we have done. We did start with photography, as Shruti has beautifully shown, and then we slowly evolved to animation. So these are all 5-6 years back that we started doing this. And then from animations, how we moved to unanimations, then augmented reality, 3D printing, holograms, and finally the 3D touch interface. So I'll take you through these 6 innovations for the next few minutes. Animations was always something which is very eye candy, because, for example, I always believe in showing a neophytes, me being a glaucoma person, what is an iris process first in a moving image. So I show them, this is what the iris process looks like, because I don't want them to get confused with an iris process and a peripheral anterior synecdoche, because these are the common encountered practical difficulties that cognitively I had during my learning days. So once I show them these animations and I prepare them and prime them that what they have to see, now I'll take them into real-time videos. It's more like mental match the following. So now I'll tell them to match. This is how the iris processes are. I'm not going into how the animations were made. I think Pawan and even Prithvi made a wonderful job of it. So it's more like cognitive match the following, as this is how you have to encounter an iris process. This is how it will look. And this is a peripheral anterior synecdoche. And this is how it will look more broader, and it will be more inserted in a more higher plane compared to an iris process. So this is, I labeled it the metaphorical conceptual learning. So you tease them and cognitively prime them. Even the YAG PA that we saw, most of the times the neophytes ask me, so why do we do a YAG PA? However, I teach them a theoretical framework. It takes more time in me telling them the pupillary block happens. Sometimes the lens may be more thicker. I show them this 10-second video that we created. I show them this video that where you see the posterior iris is in contact with the anterior surface of the lens, and obviously the aqueous production or the drainage pathway gets impaired because it has to, it always goes through this area, through the pupillary area. Now it is blocked and it is pushing the iris, causing the bowing, and the angle gets impaired. I'll just play this video once again. So a simple video helps me to demonstrate how the lens has a role, how the posterior iris gets in contact with the anterior lens, how the pupillary block happens. I tell them that the pupillary block happens in this area where I'm showing the arrow, and the angle closure happens at this plane. And we do the PA at the periphery and we open this block. So that's how a complex concept for a newly joined PG, I'll be able to convey it by a simple 10-second video. And the other real-time YAG PA video that we made, in the first month of his search, of his training in a PG, we'll be able to show him all the complex concepts. So he'll get the idea, oh, this is a pupillary block. So this is where I'm going to do my YAG PA and train him in a more cognitive way. And not only that, simple animations. Like, let us take, for example, we started making some moving images in the name IMG, I am glaucoma. And this is a simple fundus photograph. So we felt, how can we teach the glaucomatous damage in a single 1 minute? Because today, attention span of everyone is very less. So let us bring the whole glaucomatous disc changes in a single minute. So we made a stationary image moving. We brought in the zoom. We marked the plot points of where is the cup. So this is the increased cup disc ratio. Then we added more zoom to the image. And then we plotted the inferior notch. So what is a notch? So this is where the notch looks. Then this is the bayoneting sign. So we give the points of annotation focus. We give more zoom and tell them the ISNT rule is breached because the inferior notch has breached the ISNT. Then we zoom out. We show the RNF defects. So this is where the RNF defects look. So we have to cell inner plexiform layer. So this is just a single 1 minute video, but there are so many data points that can actually be taught in a single minute. So for the neophytes, how is the increased cup disc ratio seen? How is the ISNT rule breached? So all these are taken through these videos in a single fundus photograph. The idea is to bring the content in a very user-friendly way and very time effective, bringing it to a less time as possible. And slowly and steadily, we started uploading all our videos in our YouTube. And this is my YouTube channel. It goes under my name. And all the videos, all the complex phenomena, the carotid cavernous fistula, the visual pathway stroke, the abducens nerve palsy, the skew deviation, all the the very compound concepts, which are very difficult to study. It just goes a long way in theory to a page or so. And still, we find it very volatile. We made sure we bring all these concepts in 2 minutes, in 1 minute, in 30 seconds, like an Instagram Reels or like a WhatsApp story. How can we deliver high yield concepts in very short duration of time? So this is where we started our journey. And my dear friends, it goes under my name, Prasanna Venkatesh Ramesh, in YouTube. Feel free to watch the animation bouquet that we have done. So we started using the Autodesk Maya LT, and Blender software is what I really prefer. And the more animations I started to make, as Pavan pointed out, Prithvi pointed out, we felt unanimations are very important for more, like for a final year postgraduate or for a fellow, or even for my peers or people who are very young practitioners, because unanimations are what we see day in, day out. We don't see animations when we treat a patient. We'll be seeing real-time structures. So we had to again go back to our drawing board because we wanted to evolve, and we started creating unanimated real-time images of our patients. We started creating a template. So we started with the cavernous sinus. So we are just seeing how we created the cavernous sinus, all the cerebral venous sinuses in the Maya LT software. We used the Chaurasia, we used the Cunninghams. We sat together, myself, Shruti, and a team of even 4 or 5 people more. We started reading all the structures, how each are connected with each other. So we also employed a full-time designer too, because it was going beyond the scope of our imagination. And we started connecting all the dots, making all the images. It's more like creating the anatomy, recreating the anatomy in 3D, because originality is very important. We can't take, as I was telling, 3D models are available, but we need to make our own 3D models. And we wanted to go one step ahead and create real-time 3D models. What we see in our patients, we wanted to reproduce it. And we started with a simple app. It's available in the Android store. We created by us. It is IMG3D. This is a QR code, my dear friends. So what we did was, we wanted to give the users real eye models rather than animations. So we used real wide field 110 degree true color confocal fundus images for the posterior segment. And we started using slit lamp and gonioscopic photographs that we took, and we used the 3D photoreal visual. It's more like a tracing that we do to reconstruct the anatomy of the anterior segment. And we used multiple cameras inside the Unreal Engine software. It's definitely a complex software. It's not a do-it-yourself, but you can definitely try. And if the time permits in the future, we can have workshops where I'll be able to personally train other people as well. So what did we get? The end point is we place three buttons, anatomy, pathology, and we also gave the videos. If you hit the anatomy button, you get the real eyeball model as you see in the patient, and it is more unanimated learning. You click on the anterior segment, you go into the anterior segment, which is more 3D, and you get the transitions also more real. We can see the trabecular meshwork learning and the gonioscopic view or the electron microscopic. All these models are created by us. These trabecular meshwork models, it took around 3 months to 4 months for us to just create only the trabecular meshwork in a three-dimensional way. And the fundus, you can see, this is not created by us. The template was created by us. Then what it was, we took the patient's own fundus image, and just like how the two-dimensional globe can be made into a three-dimensional globe as well. When you want to rotate it, we have the globes in our desks, which we have the two-dimensional globes in a paper, which can be folded. We folded the fundus, and then by a technology called UV wrapping, and we wrapped the globe and placed it in the template that we created for the fundus to give a more real-time viewing of the fovea or the optic disc. So the viewers can click it and they can study. This is more for undergraduates and for the first year postgraduates who are orienting themselves into the real ophthalmological field. And we started evolving into multimodal imaging as well. So if there's going to be a pathology, we wanted to give them the color fundus, autofluorescence, and the infrared, for example, a flaked retina that you are seeing here, because we wanted to give the users all the possible parameters that we can give. So we started creating our 3D model atlas. So once the patient comes into our hospital, we take a full-fledged wide-field mosaic view of the fundus, a normal. This is a normal example of a normal. We also take the autofluorescence and the infrared. We started getting the deck ready, the collection of our deck, a flaked retina. This is a neovascularization with a fibrovascular band elsewhere, retinitis pigmentosa, where the color and the autofluorescence and the infrared is taken for glaucomatous retinal nerve fiber layer defects and myelinated nerve fibers. So once we started collecting various pathologies, every week we'll update the app with our pathologies. Once in 2 weeks, the IMG3D app, which is available in the Android platform, we are working on the Apple platform. Currently, it's available on Android. IMG3D is the name. And we started giving updates once in 2 weeks for the neophytes. Then the feedback that we got was, so can you give this app for us in a Windows platform as well? Because we want to see it in a much bigger display. So then with our users' feedback, we developed the Windows version of the IMG3D app, which is also available free of cost, just like IMG3D. The Windows was given, and even Windows users can use the IMG3D for a much bigger display in their Windows Mac or in the laptop. So that was the second innovation or the second journey that we took. So now we had all the 3D unanimated models with us ready. We wanted to do something more real. And we were thinking how to go forward so that it benefits in a much bigger scale. So we wanted to venture into augmented reality. So we had the models ready with us, because we now shifted from animations to unanimations, because we had our unanimations, that is reality models, ready. So we went into the Unreal Engine software and we developed the models for augmented reality. So what is augmented reality? Augmented reality was nothing but, we want to bring something into reality, but it's not real. Something that we see in the Hollywood movies, in the Iron Man movies, where Jarvis is Iron Man's friend, but he's actually an augmented reality. So we wanted to bring the learning more gamified. not only learning, even my experience today that I shared in my FRCO refraction examination, the stations are all moving towards simulations. We have more simulation counters in all the exam centers that we are facing because of the pandemic. What if we bring an augmented reality simulation center that is possible for even competitive examinations is something that I could also think of after today. So we started developing the codes for augmented reality and we upgraded our model. So these are some of the codes that we have patented, which is our intellectual property. So this is what took us a lot of time to create the codes for AR. And then what we did was we wanted to provide it on a simple phone. So if you are going to have a smartphone, currently we are working for iPhone, but we have brought it on Android phone. If you have an Android phone, all you need to do is download the IMG AR. Now this app is named AR, augmented reality, IMG AR. And you need, this is a QR code for this app. And the application's name is IMG AR. And once you focus your application, once you're on your app, you can see now, this is the user here focusing the IMG AR app on the AR template. So this is the template that I have created. And you can see on the right-hand side of your screen, what the user is trying to teach the students surrounding him. For him, it is nothing but the phone and the piece of paper. But in between the phone and the piece of paper, there is a three-dimensional hologram that is very real. What a retina sees in operation retina, or what a slit lamp examination or a doctor sees in a slit lamp, all these can be trained. And today, curriculum is also shifting towards simulations for a first-year postgraduate or for a second-year postgraduate, how we can actually train them with real-time models before we take them into real-time clinical challenges. So it is more also for simulation where we show them what is what in a three-dimensional moving way and we train them. And we also brought complex structures in neuroanatomy like the cavernous sinus. So these are something which are very, very volatile. Once you bring it into augmented reality, you can see on the right-hand side of your screen, he moves this just like a gear and he can go and visualize the parts that he wants in his comfort. Where is the superior sagittal sinus? Okay, this is how it's coming and attaching to the transverse sinus. So where am I going to look for the cavernous sinus? It's no more mugging up. So I hope I've got my concepts out there. So the cognitive learning, the anatomy learning is no more needed to be mugged up. The learning can be made more gamified. The mugging up part is now removed. The attachments can all be more learned. And this is the view that I wanted to bring it to. This is a phone view that is seen. In the phone, the user sees all these in a three-dimensional or in a four-dimensional way. Gonioscopy learning can be done. He can go and see where the gonio structures has to be seen. The anatomy is shown. Then the pathologies can be shown. He can come up and see the top angle view. He can go and see the Miyake view. How does it appear to be inside out? And he can choose the pathology buttons, see the images, how does it look, how to really see where to see what. So we can prime them in these models. And also, as I was pointing out, even for OSCE stations, for examinations, it's very much on the cards. In the future, there is a possibility the pandemic is going to consist, it's going to be consistently there. I think it's all going to be augmented reality in the future is what I'm strongly having this gut feeling, where we'll be having stations which are empty and you go take your phone and see, you'll be having all the spotters, which is just going to pop up and we'll, because it's all real time, it's not a picture. You'll have to really examine a patient, then only you'll know where to see if it's a gonio or if it's a fundus or if it's a cornea examination. So our real model is, we have not used any animated models. What we see in the patient, we have used the same images and constructed the 3D augmented reality models, be it the gonio or be it the fundus examination. These are all real-time models which make our models very unique. And the article was published in the Indian Journal of Ophthalmology Innovation section in the January issue. I think it's more theoretical also. You can go and see the theoretical aspect of this as well, because the minute intricate things are very difficult to be taught. It's more of a workshop material rather than a do-it-yourself material. And this is again one of our pictures. Shruti pointed out, it was also the cover in IJO. And we have also published a chapter on augmented reality. It's an open access. So my dear friends, you can also access this chapter. We have taken step by step how to make your own augmented reality model. So my dear friends, please make a note of it also. So how did we go about it's also a 10-step procedure, which is quite tedious, but I am always around. I can also guide you if you are interested in making your own augmented reality models, because originality is always originality. Though in internet there are so much 3D models that are available, so even for the, not only for the competitions, but originality makes you feel great. So even the small things that we make in our slide, if we make it original. My mentor Satyan Parthasarathy, he trained me that way. He used to tell me, whenever you make a slide, try to make it as original as possible. So you try to use your content rather than taking something from an internet or more. So I'll just stop there before going for the second part, sir. So there is another second part as well. So this is more 4D. Now we have covered up to 3D. I'll take some questions and then we'll go into the four-dimensional aspects.
That was really fantastic. Really fantastic. And something for which I'm sure you have worked for quite a good number of years to reach that level. So that was really amazing.
Completely mind-blowing. I think it is not meant for people like us, but we can, yes, appreciate it.
Ma'am, but definitely you can share your suggestions on the future OSCE.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Even today, when I had my experience in refraction, there was not a single patient. It was all simulations where maybe in the future, rather than placing a simple picture, if you want somebody to pick a gonioscopic finding for the FICO examinations or for the competitive FRCU examination.
I know. Surely. I mean, it's really very, very
people who really need to know where the angles are, they have to go search for it so that we get the content there. So I still hope the pandemic is in favor of these kind of simulators in the coming ages, maybe.
Yeah, definitely we would hope that the pandemic ends as soon as possible.
Yeah. But
these kinds of simulations will remain there, and definitely it's really going to be there in future, whether there is any pandemic or there is no pandemic, because it provides a very good way of teaching the postgraduate students, and these simulations and all these things are really very useful. Like, we also have simulators. How exactly it works, we don't know. But yes, it is really helpful for our, trainees and our postgraduates to.
One point I wanted to add was the two unique features of the simulators that we are trying to create is accessibility, sir. Because the cost effective comes into role. Because when it's augmented reality or mixed reality, cost plays a huge factor. So our idea was, we wanted to reach to the masses by giving it in a phone application, a complex software in the hands of everyone. This IMG Air is free of cost, sir. Even today, if anyone wants to download it in their Android phone, we are almost there. And within a week or so, we'll crack it in iPhone. I think before AAOs, we'll be able to do that. So anyone who's having a smartphone, we want to give it in their hands. And the second thing is the real images. We wanted to give it the real patient images. So that's the two things. And if there are no more questions, I'll go to the last part of the topic. Shall I move to the next one, sir? So this was, we were never satisfied, sir. Somehow me and Shruti, I keep pushing Shruti, and sometimes Shruti keep pushing me, and we wanted to see how far we can go. So we had this three-dimensional augmented holograms with us. But we wanted to see how we can go 4D. So that search within us, and I'll be showing you the team members of us. And we were always inspired from Iron Man. And so what if? Why not we do something like that? So this was whenever I used to see Robert Downey in all these Iron Man kits and everything, we used to think we can bring it into ophthalmology is what we used to plan about. And we did bring it into that. And I'm happy to share that this is one of our recent innovations, sir, which is yet to be published also. It is accepted in Indian Journal of Ophthalmology. We have brought, it's a one step further. It's called mixed reality, where we bring our tactile sensations also into play. So here in this video, you can see on the right hand side, the user appears to be moving on plain field, but we have a holographic museum with our original models being placed in space. So he is the one who's actually seeing the circle of Willis, the cavernous sinus. It's all on space. So now we can touch it, we can scale it. So these are some of the models that we have created. Even the complex anatomy of the cerebrum, it took around 6 months for us to bring all the cranial nerves, the extraocular muscles, optic radiation. We brought the eyeball structures and the color funders, autofluorescence. I'm just fast forwarding the video for want of time. And the idea was to bring in the 4D element, the touch. So now we can see the user taking the eyeball, holding the holograms in his hand, and he can scale it. He can scale it and he can, the videos are more higher GP. I think it's just playing in a bits and pieces, but hopefully I can show this again also. So you can see he's scaling the videos, he's scaling the hologram. He's now tracing the gonio with his hand. So how the gonioscopy structure looks, where the zonules are attached to the lens. So the cornea part, we have worked on 2 months back. Namrata ma'am gave us an idea for the cornea, and I'll show you the cornea as well. How the pars plana looks, how the pars plicata looks, where does each anatomical structure orient themselves with. So now the user is actually using his hands with the headset that he's wearing, and he's now learning the gonio. Every view that you want to, it's not a 360, it's more than a 360. You can rotate the eyeball in whichever frame of choice you want. The ciliary body anatomy structure studying that. Is now going to the ciliary body, studying the muscles of the ciliary body. The electron microscopic view of the angles can also be zoomed and seen. We have tried to incorporate as many finite detail as possible, and also the fundus. Not only that, we always want to give the viewers and the users more, something more. Not only the color, give them also the multimodal imaging. So there'll be more gamification. It's always more gamification, pedagogy, simulations, the IR models, the autofluorescence. I'm just forwarding the video. So all this can be tactilely accessed. And also the circle of Willis and the cavernous sinus, because we never wanted us to be constrained with ophthalmology, because neuro-ophthalmology also is a very complex field. It's so much of theory. Sometimes if something can be made very simplified, I feel it can really work wonders for the people who are studying. They don't need to mug it up. They can just see something like this and they can really cognitively orient themselves. Okay, this is where all the structures are mapped. So now he's holding the cavernous sinus. He's zooming the cavernous sinus, seeing how the sinuses are connected with each other. You can test the transverse sinus, rotate it. So it's all more immersive. This is something to be immersed, experienced in 4D. Definitely, I'll be bringing this kit to AOs and I'll be demonstrating to you, sir and ma'am. And this is something to be experienced rather than felt, but I'll try to show you as much as possible. And this is the four-dimensional model that we created. This was something that took us 4 or 5 months. So I would never put it in a do-it-yourself template. All the structures has to be read, studied, and how are we going to, all the cranial nerves, where does it start, all the nucleus, every intricate details were provided so that learning is no more mugged up. So any neuroanatomical pathologist can be easily studied that this is the red nucleus, this is how the cranial nerves are tracing and coming. So all the structures have been now provided as holograms by us. So the users can have it, they can study it, and they don't need to mug up. And not only that, once we done it for pedagogy, we got a feedback that, can you apply it for diagnostics? So this is something that 2 weeks back is something that we started again working on. We always feel there is no end point to this. It always keeps evolving. So we started slow and steadily using it for diagnostics as well. So for example, let me take you through. We have a diabetic patient who walks into us with a fundus photograph and a OCT. Obviously, the patients are having our diabetic retinopathy and the OCT is having a macular edema. So our idea was OCT is separate and the fundus photograph is separate. Can we find a common ground where we can interpolate the OCT data and the fundus photograph data? So we went ahead and we did a system in our hospital where once the images are acquired, it goes into our software, which is a translational software, which is a prototype that we are currently worked on. What it does is under 60 seconds, it gives the three-dimensional holograms and the fundus and the OCT are intermerged. So let me show you a video how. So this is 4D diagnostics. So whatever fundus section that we choose, we can cut it in the hologram, take a slice of it, and from that slice, can I take the multiple slices and see how it is in an immersive way. This really paves the way for a we do a PRP and we treat this condition, the same patient's hologram with the OCT merged with it, we can now take it, take the slices with our hands, we can choose the slice that we want to, we can show them how much the edema has really come down. This is 4D. It's completely immersive. The patient will definitely appreciate it, that it's because we are treating the edema three-dimensionally. So we can show them this is how we have taken you through with a single injection or with a laser. This patient can be shown how we have brought down the edema. So this is all something that we are now working on. And last time when I presented this in a YOSI forum, that was the time when Madam Namrata Madam gave me an idea that why don't you think of cornea as well? Because at that point onwards, I was thinking more to retina and glaucoma point of view. So then slowly I told my team, yes, this is time for us to move towards cornea. So slow and steady, we started using some striate keratopathy. So this was, a striate keratopathy is quite normal for any surgery that takes a long time. So we thought we'll go slow and steady. So we started using Schimpflug imaging and ASOCT to map the cornea. So then what we did was we pasted the cornea also, just like the fundus that we started placing. So the holograms, we started making it for the cornea as well. So this can be applied for corneal dystrophies, any corneal pathologies. So just get away for a slide. The band is not allowing me to play the video. It's rather a smooth video, but it's a hologram. The cornea holograms can be chosen. So the imagination is the patient's follow-up also can be done in a holographic way. Maybe 10 years down the road or 20 years down the road, 4D diagnostics is going to come. And this is one of our patients with a Christmas tree cataract. Even lens that can also be studied, a posterior polar cataract, a Christmas tree cataract. It can create a hologram and the surgeons can discuss, okay, with the anterior today giving us the exact slice where the pole is there and the PC dehiscence is there. The consultants can teach the surgeons that this is where we are going to do. You'll have to take your cannula to this depth and this is how you'll have to, maybe you will not advise to do a hydro delineation. But we can plan the surgery in a holographic way. So this is a Christmas tree cataract that we photograph, and it can also be seen 360 degrees. The more slit lamp photographs that we take, the more the lens also can be studied. The cornea also can be studied. It's completely 4D with all the structures in ophthalmology can be brought into the holograms. So, and also ultrasound, even the ultrasound biomicroscopy that we do, we can also get all the slices of the ultrasound biomicroscopy. And we also create an ultrasonic hologram as well. So that if somebody is going to send me a photograph of a scan, I'm not very comfortable. Whereas if they send me all the slices, I can know what really happens. It's something like that we experience in a CT or MRI. The radiologist doesn't go through a single slice. He goes through a section of each slices to make the diagnosis. I feel when some of our fellows send in telemedicine a single slice of image, so what could be the diagnosis? I say it's very difficult to make a diagnosis. If you give me all the slices, I can really make a very good diagnosis because I have more data points to go with. So we have done a holographic metaverse. And to just end with a couple of slides, I also feel 3D is more real. The more we move into virtual reality, augmented reality, and the 4D mixed reality, I also feel we should have a touch with reality as well. Because my idea is we need to cater to a wider audience. We always need to give the users every possible expression. So we also printed these structures in 3D as a puzzle. So just like an automobile engineer assembles the bike sets in his curriculum, it can be brought up in the future where you assemble your cavernous sinus to learn which parts gets connected to where, assemble the eyeball models. These are all undergraduate or a first year postgraduate material where 3D puzzle assembly can be brought into the curriculum as well. And the last but not least, this is the Innovation 6, which we are which we have launched very recently as well, which is called the Eye Touch. So many people told, can you give us very simple, because this was the first iPhone application that we brought, which is EYE MG Max. So it's in the iOS platform. So this was the first Android phone where we brought in the touch. With the touch itself, you can rotate the eye. It's in your phone. Because we wanted to also have a connectivity with the Android users and the iPhone users who are the maximum. Because holograms, though it's good and flashy, it is still having a longer time to come into the market and penetrate. So we brought all the structures in touch as well. So our idea, my aim was to always build a team to make the images moving. And we were lucky to make the Mahatma Center of Moving Images brought up. And myself and Shruti is my another person who's always been having my back. So what without Shruti is also, it's impossible for me. Though it's my vision, she has always been the 50% part of it. She always helps me and she bears the 50% stress of mine. And today we are an 8-member team. We felt it's growing more. So we felt we need to have our own separate iOS coder. And we also had 2 optometrists are there in our team because we create a lot of anatomies, a lot of 3D proofreading. I say the 3D proofreading. We always have to keep reading Cunningham's Chaurasia to make sure the data is always right. All the structures goes and connects in. So always, we always go back to anatomy. We keep reading the anatomy because we keep creating new structures. And MCMA is a unique department. I feel for ophthalmology, ours is one of the departments that the Center of Moving Images, where we have done these 6 innovations. And my dear friends, if you have missed any of my points, I think this slide will make you cover it. The animations are there in my YouTube channel under my name, Prasanna Venkatesh Ramesh. The unanimations and augmented reality are available in the QR code that you can scan. The 3D puzzles are available free of cost. We have provided our models in our website. And the holograms, you need to have HoloLens to use the holograms. And we have launched the IMG Max, which is available on the Android Apple forum. And all the publications are all innovations. So five of it we have published in innovation sections in our prestigious Indian Journal of Ophthalmology. So you can also go back, read all the contents that I have told you. In our article, we have also given you more detail as to how we thought of it. How did we make each and every innovation that we made? So all the 5, and IMG Max is yet to be published, but soon we'll be making that also. Our idea was to give everything in every platform, not only have it in Apple or Android, Windows or Mac. We want to give it in every platform so that even in a 3D printed puzzle. So let the user choose his platform. If he's a touch platform, we have it there also. So we wanted to cover every platform as possible so that we cover as many people as possible. So our aim is to bring in 4D ophthalmic diagnostics, low vision rehabilitation, at least the counseling to start off in 4D, 4D telemedicine with holograms and 4D artificial intelligence as well, 4D multimodal imaging for retinal diseases, as well as for cornea, as we have slowly started with the anterior images that we have started to collect. Pedagogy, because the teachers that we are and the teaching that we are going to do, how much theory that we do is going to take us a lot of time, but with holograms, I felt its learning can be done very quickly for the neophytes. Ours is a cutting-edge, patent-protected 4D technology, which is a translational software. It's not an imaging software, my dear friends. You need an imaging technique. Once you do an imaging, our software will make you convert it into a hologram. And our team is there, myself is there, and Shruti, she's also part of our team. And we have 6 more members. Ours is a Center of Moving Images is what we go under the name MCMI. And there is a lot of things that we have given on different platforms. And with that, I thank Rajesh sir and Namrata ma'am. A week before, when I got that elusive call from Rajesh sir, I was very joyed and excited that Rajesh sir is giving me such a wonderful opportunity for us to showcase this talent, because this is the first time I'm meeting sir, so I was very nervously excited as well. So thank you, sir. And last but not least, I'm happy to share that our image has been selected for the DreamCon cover image as well. Yesterday, Partha sir shared this wonderful news with us that the DreamCon shared this image of us, that this image, again, everything had a learning curve and we took a lot of time. But somehow, as Shruti told, an image speaks 1,000 words. For us, what do we make the image moving? Our vision is a question mark. What if we make an image moving? Will it be more than 1,000 words? So with that point, I end this talk, and thanks to all and all the seniors and my peers and my juniors. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, man.
Definitely many more than 1,000 words. It was mind-blowing.
Fantastic. Hats off to you, Prasanna and Shruti, and the entire team for conceiving this and then for making it happen and for giving the shape that it is.
Yes, ma'am. Thanks to you, ma'am. Like 1 month back, I didn't think in terms of cornea. Now slowly cornea and refractive part of it. So there is no point, end point is what I see, ma'am. So we keep evolving, and I think with time we'll be able to crack it for 4D diagnostics as well.
4D is very exciting because it adds a feeling, I mean, it adds a dimension of proprioception to it. Something, you know, it's a different, it's another sense that you are adding. Otherwise, you only have, you know, hearing or you only have seeing, but this has a third sense to it, and that is touching.
For that, you need a special goggle, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, currently the goggles are available, sir. And Jio is also coming up with their own goggles. Mm-hmm. It's quite costly. It's around $3,500. But with Jio coming into the market, I would take the comparison to an iPhone. When iPhone came into the market, it appeared to be very costly. But now everyone is able to afford it and they're able to have it. So similarly, maybe it will take some time. But now the kids have started to get this goggle, sir. With Jio launching in, everyone will be having their own goggle sets for playing games. So this is how it's going to start. They're going to have it for games, and then slowly it's going to evolve into academics as well. So once Jio launches it, I think it should not, the cost should not be a matter, where every data can be in 4D. So that's the idea.
So Rajesh, I think we have a AIOS technology pavilion, which we are launching for the first time, both me and Rajesh in the DreamCon meeting, and I would I think Rajesh would agree with me completely that we would want to have your presentation into that AI technology pavilion.
I'm on all Fridays, ma'am. I'm available for all the Fridays anytime. Yeah. And I would love to show this to you in person, ma'am, because though this is again 2D, I'm in 2D and sir is in 2D, like Shruti was talking, we are all in 2D forum. This is, once you see it, you experience it. So now we have started suturing also, ma'am, like simple suturing. How can we bring it into a holograms so that we train them, the especially the hand-eye coordination and the spatial orientation. So these are the two things that is challenging for a young person who sits under the microscope. The hand-eye coordination and the spatial orientation is what is really challenging for us to build in them. So when we show these things and bring in the, maybe it'll take some time for me to develop this, but I think with time, the suturing, the hand-eye coordination for simple procedures is what we are trying to work forward. But currently, this is where we stand. I think 2 months back when I presented this to Namrata, ma'am, we have slightly, slow and steadily, we are evolving.
No. For me, it's a complete change from what you presented and from now, what now it is today, and it has happened too fast.
Yes, ma'am. And unfortunately, I didn't have this ready for DOS. For DOS, I had to present my app. It was a very basic one, but slow and steadily we are now bringing it up. Man. So
then, definitely your presentation in the AIOS.
Prasanna, you and Shruti and your entire team, I think we'll take this thing to the AIOS Technology Pavilion in the DOS in the AIOS conference between 2nd and 5th June. So you let us know. I think it will require about 1 hour.
If I may add a point, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. If I may add a point. We are now a team of iOS engineers, 4D generalists, 3D generalists. So we are now grown into a huge team. Even if you want us to have workshops, ma'am, it's very much possible. Like not really the hi-fi tech. Some people, they would want to know only the basic, like you just tell me 1 or 2 points. So even if there is to be a workshop or something, I can come up with my team also, ma'am, like technical aspects of it, simple basic software startup. I'm just putting a word to the word. So everything is possible, ma'am. Like 4D and even 5D is also possible. Like 5D is like,
let us understand 4D first, yeah. Prasanna, you are understanding.
5D is operating from our home, ma'am. Like we sync with the, I think Good Doctor in Netflix has 5D. where you have everything as a hologram. And in all Steven Spielberg's movie, you can see 5D, ma'am. Like,
my God.
You imagine yourself that there is a pandemic and you can operate your patient from your home because you're synced with the gadgets in your hospital and you are operating on 5D. So I think we'll get there, ma'am. It will take some time, but
you will get there definitely. And we will get there 60, with 70, you.
Everything you will get definitely. The way you are moving, it's really mind-blowing.
And
we would love to have some workshop related to this, definitely.
Even the technical points of it, no, sir. Like some doctors will be willing to learn this, but they'll not be having the time. But they'll be having their IT person who'll be willing to learn it and incorporate it in their setup. So I can even bring my IT person so that they will teach their IT person that these are the things that you need to do. So they can innovate their own system. So the do-it-yourself can be done by the IT personnel of the doctors, because we'll be oriented with OPDs and surgeries, which will be difficult for us to learn these gadgets. But the IT people can add on to the new thing. So just a thought, sir. Yeah.
True. That's very true.
And Shruti has always been very patient. Even she's my pillar here. So I disturbed her at odd times at night, or I don't allow her to sleep. She's my sister also, sir, incidentally. So she's a very good support for me. Thank you, Shruti. I would like to acknowledge her also.
Yeah.
Not be fair on my
part. Thank you so much.
Acknowledge her contribution. It's always a team rather than a single man's effort is what I always tell. Even all the 8 members of my team, I tell them, each one of us, you have a role. Because currently the iOS platform is very difficult to crack, sir. Any app that we make, it's very easy to launch it in Android. But in iOS, it is undergoing a peer-reviewed process, just like a journal. He evaluates it. He sees whether it is of good quality, whether the layering has been done right, and then only he publishes it. Just like that, it's not done in an iOS platform. So even a small iOS coder, he has a huge impact to make. So yeah. Thank you, sir, and ma'am, for the opportunity. Yeah.
Thank you, Prasanna. So this webinar was really wonderful. A lot of things to learn, a lot of things, new things, a lot of things that were presented. You know, that shows that, you know, how understanding and teaching in the field of ophthalmology is going to change in future. So that was really amazing and wonderful. Ma'am, anything you would like to say?
I think that was a fantastic web. I mean, it was, I think, the best webinar we've had, with so much of new things, so much of novelty in it, and a very futuristic one, you know, how we have to look into future. So I think thank you, Shruti and Prasanna, and everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So in the end, I would
thank you so much
for actually conceptualizing this webinar, actually. So thanks a lot for that. And of course, another thanks for the presentation that you gave, and many things that you tried to make us understand. Obviously, we could not understand everything, how you did all those holograms and all that, but definitely it was very encouraging. And of course, Shruti, your presentation again was fantastic. Thanks a lot. I would like to
thank you, sir.
Pavan as well. Both presented very well. Thanks to all 4 of you.
Thank you, sir.
I'd like to acknowledge the efforts of the staff, our staff, Mr. Anil Kumar, and IT person Bageshwar, and of course, the IT team of IPCA and IPCA for supporting this webinar. So thank you very much. Big thanks to all of you, and hope to see you soon again. And good night to all of you.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.